This morning, we're going to be coming from an Old Testament passage, and then we're going to go to the New Testament. We're going to begin in Psalm 46. We're going to read verse 1, and then we're going to go to 9 through 11. When you get that, put your finger there, and we're going to go to Matthew, the first book of the New Testament. Chapter 21. We're going to read verses 6 through 11. When you have it, say amen. That's Psalm 46 and Matthew 21. Refuge and strength, and ever-present help in trouble. Then we go to verse 9, and it says, He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God.
Yes.
I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Going to Matthew chapter 21. Beginning with verse 6. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." For our title this morning, Be Still and Know. Political office holders who are supposed to equally represent the communities they serve openly make blatant racial slurs and comments which go unchecked. Those in power change the rules and policies almost daily, not only to get their way, but to try to stay in power by redistricting voters. And the latest, our president ordered missiles be launched at Syria, first giving them a heads up that it was coming. And the list goes on. It would seem the United States is headed for a rough 1,303 days until the next election. Church, we need to pray.
Amen.
And our prayers must be active rather than passive. We must certainly pray, but we must also put some feet, hands, and a voice to those prayers. We must ask God, "What would you have me do?" Knowing that to make a difference, it only takes four: you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
All right, now.
You see, God gives you strength. Jesus gives you the authority, and the Holy Spirit gives you the direction. It's time to suit up, saints, because the war we're about to wage is not physical. For most of us, that ship has sailed. Some of us got our tickets punched, and we served in the military, and for others, you either missed your opportunity or chose not to go through that window. But don't feel bad, only 1% of Americans do. Nevertheless, we are all still soldiers in the army of the Lord,
right,
and we need to suit up. But more than that, we need to understand who the real commander-in-chief is and understand that he's got us.
Amen.
The psalmist says, "God is our refuge and strength." In Proverbs, Solomon says it this way: "The name of the Lord is a strong tower.
Yes.
The righteous run into it and is safe." The tower is a defensive place where the soldiers are up high in the tower and the opposition is trying to fight from a lower position. And how many know you can't fight and climb at the same time?
Amen.
So we're in the safety of the Lord. God is our refuge, and not only that, he's our strength. We are weak and frail when it comes to fighting the enemy, but Paul tells us in Philippians, "I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me."
That's right.
And in Romans we learn, if God be for us, who can be against us? We are mighty in Christ Jesus, but despite that, he's still an ever-present help in trouble. Are we in trouble today? Is America, a nation built on the principles of religious freedoms, in trouble today? We are now a nation who, in a 2015 survey, identified that 75% of the people they spoke with claim to be Christian. This is down from 86% in 1990. And just 62% of those surveyed claim to be members of a church congregation. When you put those numbers with registered voters and those who actually get out and vote, no wonder we're in the situation we're in. We are a nation who is turning away from God, only to call on him when tragedy strikes. After 9/11 and when the World Trade Center's towers came down, the churches were full. We'll call on him in time of trouble. And I'm so glad that God is an ever-present help in trouble.
Amen.
That means God will always be there when trouble comes our way, even if we're not faithful to him.
Amen.
Now, this is exciting. He makes wars to cease to the ends of the earth.
Amen.
God will protect us. He can destroy our enemies. He can destroy their weapons. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. Wars have gone on almost since the beginning of man's time here on this earth. When Adam and Eve had their two sons, Cain and Abel, that was the first war with a casualty. It matters not that there was just two of them, but those two had a war, and Abel lost. He ends the war by breaking the bow, shattering the spear and burning the shields with fire. That's why Paul tells us in Ephesians 6 to put on the whole armor of God,
yeah,
so that we can fight against the wiles of the devil. We're not fighting against flesh and blood, so because we're not fighting against flesh and blood, those carnal weapons won't work. And here's what we can shout about. He says, God says, be still
and know that I am God.
Yeah.
When God says be still, he's talking to the heathens. He's talking to our enemies, not us, not the Christians. You prepare for battle. God is telling our opponent to be still and know. In other words, you better recognize that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. And not only that, I will be exalted in the earth. You see, it doesn't matter what things look like around us. Who's trying to start war? God is still in control. As for the Christian, the Lord Almighty is with us.
Yeah.
The God of Jacob is our fortress. The God of Jacob is our fortress because we are adopted into the family by the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
The one and only Son who died for our sins, that we might have a right to the tree of life.
Amen.
And on this day that we know as Palm Sunday, Jesus began the journey of a week that would change the course of our lives. While that day began, the day was born, he was born of a virgin, this day marks the beginning of what is known as Passion Week. On this day, the disciples went and did it as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. Now I have to stop right there and back up for just a moment. In verse 2 and 3, he has given the disciples instructions to go borrow this donkey and colt, and if anyone asks, tell them the Lord needs them. Jesus, the King of the Jews, the long-awaited Redeemer, our Savior, the Son of God, had to borrow a donkey to make his triumphant entry on. He owned nothing, yet he owned everything, and not too proud to say he had need. So what's wrong with us? Why won't we ask for help? We need to strive to be more like Jesus in every area of our lives. Amen?
Amen.
So Jesus borrowing this donkey and colt, you see, prior to this, Jesus went from place to place carrying out his ministry, and he walked miles and miles on dirt roads in sandals. But he did it. And we? Well, that's another story. Typically, a king would ride on a beautiful horse or be carried in a chariot with much pomp and circumstance, trumpets blowing, da da da, perhaps a herald announcing his arrival. Here he comes, the King of the Jews. But Jesus didn't even own a donkey, let alone a horse, chariot, or have heralds announcing him. But as he came into Jerusalem for what was to be the last time, his disciples placed their cloaks on the donkey and colt for him to sit on. The very large crowd ran ahead of him and decorated his path. Some of them spread their cloaks on the road while others cut down branches from the trees and spread those on the road. The crowd, though many were poor, tried to give Jesus a grand entry as he rode in on an ass, a work animal, and a borrowed one at that. But the people tried, and he didn't have heralds, but the people cried, Hosanna, which means save now we beseech or we beg thee. Save them from what? The oppression they were under by the Roman government, the heavy taxes they had to pay, the unfair treatment that they suffered. They cried, Hosanna to the Son of David. David was their greatest king, a man after God's own heart, and here was his heir to the throne. And the people desperately wanted him to take what they believed to be his rightful place as their king and rise up against the Romans. They wanted him to make them a great nation once again. But this was not his assignment. Christ knew his assignment, and he was obedient to the Father. Could you have the rightful authority and choose to submit even unto death? Jesus did. They continued, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heavens. As any normal person would, hearing all the ruckus, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? Who is this the people are making all this noise about? Now picture with me, if you will, you're in Jerusalem, and on the day of this Passover celebration, you're at the market getting your preparations for the feast that's coming later, and this very large crowd is taking off their clothes, breaking branches off the trees, and laying them on the road, and shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. So they've got your attention. And you're looking to see who's coming, but you can't see through the crowd. So you excuse your way on up to the front, and you see Jesus, the carpenter's son, riding in on a donkey.
What?
Surely your eyes and ears must be deceiving you.
Sure.
Who is this? And they excitedly tell you, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. Well, they are correct. But the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee doesn't even begin to tell who Jesus is.
Come on now.
He's the image of the invisible God.
Yeah, yeah.
He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Uh-huh.
He's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end.
Yeah.
He's the author and finisher of our faith.
Uh-huh.
He's the author of eternal salvation.
Yes.
He's the beloved Son,
yes, uh-huh.
Bread of life,
yes.
The cornerstone,
yes.
The deliverer,
yes.
The door.
Yes.
The faithful witness,
yes.
The glory of God,
yes.
The good shepherd,
yes.
The great high priest, Jehovah, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi,
yes.
Jehovah Tiskanu, the just one, the lawgiver, the Lamb of God, light of the world, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, our mediator and Messiah, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, my rock, my redeemer, the light, the truth, and the true vine, the Word made flesh. He's Jesus, our way maker. But he humbled himself.
Yes, he did.
Unashamed to ask for help, and rode into Jerusalem on that borrowed donkey. As the people shouted for him, he knew what he was going into. He knew while today they shouted Hosanna, at the end of the week they would be shouting something else. He knew that at the end of the week his mission would be coming to an end. He knew that his time on this earth was short. He knew he'd be betrayed by one of his inner circle, with a kiss even. He knew it was all part of the plan.
Yes.
The plan that had to be carried out for us because sin required a blood sacrifice, and Jesus was the Lamb without spot or wrinkle who came to save us from our fiery grave.
Yes.
We were on our way to hell. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
He took off glory and put on humanity.
Yes.
He took off being omnipresent to put on a frail body that hungered and thirsted,
yes,
and felt pain,
mm-hmm,
and got tired.
Mm-hmm.
He maintained his power, but allowed himself to be beaten all night long.
All night.
He allowed himself to be led like a sheep to slaughter, never saying a mumbling word.
Mm-hmm.
He allowed himself to be hung on a cross.
Mm-hmm.
He allowed them to place a crown of thorns on his head.
Mm-hmm.
I say he allowed because at any time he could have called a legion.
That's right.
He could have called 10,000 angels,
uh-huh,
to take him down. He could have rained fire down from heaven to kill all of his persecutors. But he endured the death, even the death of the cross.
That's right.
And when all of our sin debt had been paid, he gave up the ghost,
yeah,
and died. But they weren't through with him yet. They pierced him in his side.
Mm-hmm.
And when the water and the blood ran from his body, they thought they had defeated him.
Uh-huh.
The people didn't recognize who Jesus truly was.
That's right.
But even the earth knew it. In the middle of the day, at the noonday hour, darkness covered the earth. Even the sun mourned the death of the Savior.
Uh-huh.
Oh, but wait a minute. That's not where the story ends. They took him down off that cross. They placed his body in a borrowed tomb, and 3 days later, he got up. He got up with all power in his hands. He got up after defeating death, hell, and the grave. Then he ascended to the right hand of the Father, and in my spiritual imagination, I see the Father saying, "Welcome back. Welcome back, son. It's good to see you." Will God say to you, "Welcome, it's good to see you. Enter thou into the glory of the Lord"?
Yes.
Well, it depends. Have you made Jesus Lord of your life?
Yes.
If not, you'll hear, "Depart from me, ye worker of iniquity." But I've got good news.
Good news.
Because you're here,
yes,
you have the opportunity this day to change God's salutation to you. If you've never accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, today is a good day.
Good.
The doors of the church are open.
Amen.
Let us stand.
Amen.
Amen. Be still.
Good day.
And know that I am God.